Welcome back to the Jenna Julien Podcast, this week with our special guest, Sarah Patterson.
Yay! Thanks, guys.
Sarah Patterson, formerly Sarah Rice, from The Challenge on MTV. Huge fans of you. Thank you so much for coming to our house and doing this podcast with us.
Thanks for having me.
I'm so excited too. This episode of the Jenna Julien Podcast is brought to you by The Tracker. This tiny coin-sized device can make sure you don't lose any of your belongings ever again. Guys, the battery lasts for a year. It locates via GPS on your phone. There's an app for it. It's incredible. I've put one on everything I own, my drone, my bags, everything. It's super awesome. Get yourself a Tracker. You get 30% off right now when you go to thetracker.com and use promo code Jenna Julien. Thanks to The Tracker.
Thank you, Tracker. All right.
Okay.
Sarah, how you doing?
How you doing, Sarah?
I'm great.
How you doing, girl?
I love your dogs.
Aw, they're sweet.
They're sweet. Marble's...
They like you.
He takes a while to warm up, but... You know, they're all, yeah, they're a good little bunch. Marble barked at you for like a couple minutes when you walked in.
Then he was cool with me, so yeah. That's okay.
He was cool with you. That's a good sign.
Yeah.
Because sometimes
doing his job.
He's not cool with you after a little while.
Yeah.
If you're a murderer.
Or if you
if you take a lot of money from people on challenges, I bet you would not like that.
Marvin knows.
Shots fired. Wham,
you guys have like a soundboard on your podcast.
Like the best or slash worst idea, because now I spend most of my time scrolling through deciding what sound effect I want to use next. Oh, and then I upgraded and got 300. So now, of the 300, 10 are cool.
Yeah.
And
so many sounds.
But you have them like ready live. And
So many animal noises.
We need one of those.
Yeah.
I know. I was thinking about hooking up my machine.
It cost a whopping 99 cents. So.
What?
You know.
Is it like an
spend
app?
Your money wisely. Yes, it's an app on your own.
What am I doing?
Yeah, I don't know what you're doing.
Oh, yeah. Brutal.
That's pretty sick. Okay, so first of all, we're really excited to have you here.
We're a mess.
We don't have guests very often, so when we do, we get really excited. But we're massive fans of you. We watch The Challenge. She's gotten me into it for the last couple of years, and we watch it, and it's a show we enjoy watching. But there's definitely been a few competitors that we really enjoy, and you're definitely one of those.
Oh, thanks.
That we like watching. And obviously, there's a crazy whole situation we want to talk about this last season, about how it ended. We will get completely into that, but I think it's important to just get to know you first really quickly.
Oh my god, I love that. How nice.
So Sarah, you're currently in grad school.
Yes.
At the place when I went to college.
Yes. Oh my god, I can't believe that. We walked in and I was talking about where I went to school or where I'm living and blah blah blah, and he's like, "Oh yeah, I live right by there." Or you went to school right by there. Oh, at the school I go to right now.
No big deal.
No big deal.
So you're getting your master's right now.
I am.
That's really exciting.
And not all reality television people.
No,
just
and
live
we
on
never.
Reality television.
You watched our bachelor episode, and you're like, "Oh, they're gonna think I'm stupid."
I did. I was like, "That okay?" Now I just maybe that's why I went out and got a master's. I need like a PhD to just prove to people that I'm not a reality television.
Even
show
even if that's the reason, that's a good reason. Go
yeah,
do
no,
it. Right?
Good enough, right?
Yeah,
good enough.
That's all you need.
Yeah, it took me however many thousands of dollars.
Well, Jenna's been there. She got her master's in sports psychology.
And counseling.
Oh,
yeah.
I was thinking of doing that. That's amazing.
That's pretty awesome.
Oh, I would love to pick your brain about sports psychology. That's great.
No regrets.
You can pick
really
it right
cool.
now.
Oh
I know. I was actually. I wanted to bring that up because I knew that.
I didn't go to Chapman though, so I feel left out.
No, but it doesn't. That, but you did something super cool.
Yeah. She's joking.
Well, he doesn't have a master's degree.
No.
Do you? So, of course, technically, I don't either yet. So
yeah, you don't either. Jenna will see herself out now.
I'm the worst.
So you want to open your own practice eventually, which is cool.
You know what's funny is I really started seeing the need for somebody to offer counseling or therapy to people who've been on reality television shows.
Mm.
And that does not really exist.
There's not like a specific...
No.
Yeah.
And I even tried to get counseling... through, connections I had and nobody really knew where to send me.
Wow.
And still is sending me.
That's
somebody
really
needs to do it.
Yeah.
And because
for sure.
It really is a strange transition to being in an environment where every single day they ask you for your opinion on everything. And then you go back to real life and guess what? Your opinion doesn't fucking matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what you think about what time, Joe Schmo woke up and if he's depressed or not, because it's not your business.
Yeah.
So people have a really hard time.
It is a very specific sort of therapy that, or discussion, you know, therapy, talk therapy, mm-hmm. whatever you want to call it, what someone would need from going on reality TV, especially a lot.
Well, and also I talk with Susie, who is on my co-host on the podcast, that it raises your bar for excitement. For, you know, when you do the things we've done in the challenge and you jump off cliffs and you get put to the test and your adrenaline is at a high all the time and you're getting all that crazy stuff, you know, brain chemical kind of stuff from it. Sure. Then you go to your regular life mm-hmm. and like nothing's exciting.
Yeah. It's like a life of adrenaline dump.
Yes. Yeah. So you see people who, there's like this great quote that says, I'm a dragon slayer and there are no more dragons. And so like, what do you do?
Yeah.
And when like, so you see people who fall into these very dark holes of, you know, whatever it is. And there unfortunately has been many situations where people have turned to drugs or alcohol and things like that. And I've seen it right and left. I've seen it happen with people who've passed away who were on the show. And yeah. I know that if they had the right kind of help afterwards, maybe different. Whoa, I made this dark.
No, it's important.
This is what I live for, first of all.
Great.
Second of all, that's a lot of people mm-hmm. that are in need of the same service that, not that I'm aware of, anyone is currently.
No, I have never heard of it. And nobody, and I'm looking for it. I mean, right. after everything that happened, I was looking for it. And there was nothing.
Yeah.
And I started doing the numbers. I'm like, okay, we have 24 contestants on our show. Mm. Then there are, you know, 30 or whatever on Are You the One? Then you go down, there's probably 2,000 plus people every 6 months who
just
are going in
MTV
and out
alone.
Of reality television shows.
Yeah.
And it messes you up.
Yeah. And I mean, it can't not.
There's no way it can't.
Yeah.
And it's like,
exactly. Like it might be easy to blame someone and be like, oh, you just love the attention. But like, if you're in that situation, yeah. it's that transition is insane. You mentioned your podcast. First of all, she has an awesome podcast. It's called the Brain Candy Podcast.
Yeah.
We can get more into
with
that later.
With Susie,
who is also
from
on the challenge.
Challenge
and
original
Road Rules.
And Road Rules. She hates them. Well, she hates when I say she's from Real
Did
World.
I just make
and
folly?
She, you know,
you made
she's
a folly.
From.
You done goofed it.
I made a folly.
But I listened to one of your recent episodes about the recap of the finale. And you said something on there that like really kind of painted it in a way that I could understand. It's like, you know, every second of being on the challenge, you're stuck a camera in your face and you're trying to be made to create something for them to have something to film and whatnot. And the moment it ends, you do not matter. Like the
Nothing.
Moment the cameras
I
go
mean,
off, they are packing up. You couldn't, like you said, you couldn't have sex right there and they
wouldn't
have put the camera on.
Did I say that? Yeah, it's totally accurate.
Yeah.
Yeah. It sounds about right. Yeah.
It's wild to think about that. Just that on and off switch.
It really is like you may as well be invisible.
Yeah.
It is the strangest feeling to have everybody care about you and then nobody give a fuck what you're doing.
Yeah. Like on
and
the drop
people
of
do.
A dime,
they leave
like right
and
away.
They go and hook up that night and it's like the craziest stuff happens the night after a challenge.
Mm.
And once the filming all ends, it's shocking. It's shocking.
Yeah.
It's well, in sports psychology, one of the things you have to work with athletes a lot is that when you spend your entire life or 10 years or 10,000 hours or however long, like completely invested in something, it's part of your identity, and then you stop, like people transitioning out of their career is one of the hardest things for them. And there's all kinds of counselors for professional athletes that are now done with their
that.
Job.
Yeah.
And helping them transition into being a normal person.
Mm-hmm.
There is nothing like that for reality show people. There's no one that I think even has a level of expertise that would understand how to help you.
And it's so, you know, it's so easy. Like I watch reality television shows too. And I just think like, oh my God, these idiots, like they know what their fault. They put themselves in these kind of situations. But when you're in it, you don't realize what is happening to you. It's like being a child
and
in an
you don't
abusive,
know what their reality is.
Or it's like being trapped in an abusive relationship where they give you, especially when it's those shows that happen over and over and over, where it's like, it may have been terrible, but then you think back and you're like, oh man, but it was so much fun. And then afterwards we got to do this, we got to travel and it was great. And then they call you on the phone and they're like, remember all these good times? Plus we'll give you like just a little bit, you know, dangle the carrot in front of you. And then you think, okay, where else am I going to get those adrenaline rushes?
Yeah.
And you say yes.
It's like a drug.
Yeah, it is a drug.
Yeah. You find your ways, like making excuses or justifying why it was fun, even though a lot of it wasn't.
But it's impossible to have a real life. I mean, it's completely impossible. You can't. I mean, it's taken me 10 plus years to get through what should have taken me 4 years in school because you take breaks and what job is going to hire you.
It's like you're relapsing. Like,
yeah, really. Yeah. It really is. And I had to finally be like, okay, I hit rock bottom. Yeah. Is what happened.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, well, this sucks. Mm-hmm. And it's almost a good thing everything that happened, because if I would have if everything would have happened great,
you would have gone.
I might have gone back.
Yeah. Well, let's jump into that. I mean, you had jumping way back. Okay, this season was Rivals 3.
Yeah.
You were paired up with Johnny Bananas, yeah, who you guys were previously Rivals with, and now are, I guess would say are currently Rivals. In real life, you just don't talk to each other.
Right.
Not even use the word rival.
Yeah.
The season really fucked me up. And you saw, I think, because people...
Julian was really upset.
I was fucked up.
That was the most touching. You seeing that video that you did and watching Susie cry, I think, were the two things that I felt like all of my feelings were justified.
Mm.
And I was like, good, I'm glad, because I didn't feel like that from the people running the show, and I didn't feel like that from my cast members, and I didn't feel like that from, you know.
Yeah. And I can't imagine what you did feel like. Like, there's no way
numb.
To even... Because if a person who's completely removed from everything, especially an extra step removed, because when I watch the challenge, I don't invest. I'm like, it's surface level entertainment. And so for me to feel something like that strongly and really, like, I couldn't stop thinking about it the next day. And I was like, what the fuck is the matter with me? This is a challenge.
But
I couldn't stop thinking about it.
Julian was fucked.
Because, and you know, the reason it really fucked with me, it was because, you know, the whole season, you guys mending your friendship and this kind of really harmonious teammate.
It was pretty beautiful.
That was
beautiful.
So real for me.
And I don't doubt that. You know what I mean? Like, I don't doubt that was real, because I could see, you know.
But I don't think it was real for him.
Yeah.
That's the sad part.
Yeah.
But not to cut you off.
No. It was one of those things where I said to Jenna right before the decision happened, I was like, oh, there's no way. There's no way. Like, there's no way if anyone even paid him money on the show to do
that's
it.
That's what I thought.
Right.
I was like, there's no fucking way.
Offering him money to make that decision and also offering you money. And also, so you can say sea turtle if you can't talk about any of it.
No. Yeah. I wish.
Mm.
I wish that were the case.
Because then maybe it would be understandable.
Yes. Yeah. And if he would have given me like a wink-wink, no.
Wow.
Nothing.
Yeah.
And at the top of the mountain, he said, we were like not allowed to talk to each other. Because I thought everything was fine, blah, blah, blah. And he said...
They want it like that, though.
He said, if I ever did that, they would burn me at the stake. He's like, I got so much heat after, you know, just saying the things I did to you after your decision, like, which, by the way, is not the same thing.
It's not
thing.
The same at all. It's not the same at all.
Ugh. Okay.
Really quick. Can we explain what happened to people who didn't watch?
Is my mic
I don't
on?
Know. I feel like it.
Whatever. Forget
no,
it.
Sounds, like it. I hear it.
I mean, it sounds really
it
low.
Sad.
Hold on. Keep talking.
Girl, hey.
No.
That's better.
Is it?
No, it's not. Anyways. But for those of you that haven't watched the show, or maybe you're international and you don't watch it, like a while ago, you threw him into a last elimination sort of deal, but you still gave him the opportunity to win that.
And also, he was not my partner. He was the opposite team.
Correct.
We were not on the same team. I was competing against him. And the goal of the game is to get my team across the finish line.
Right.
Fair game. Mm-hmm. That I'm all about playing fair. Like, that's totally cool. Fair game. Like, do what you got to do to get your team across the finish line. I don't care how you do it. But the idea of going against the person that you are a team with is insane to me.
And it's completely
I would never do that. I would never do that.
Yeah.
I just think it's a crime that people are even comparing the two things.
Right. The fact that he has justified it in his head, and it shows how... I mean, whatever he needs to say. I mean, but he will. He'll twist it and make it whatever he wants.
So
there
was some bad blood because Sarah had thrown him into an elimination in a season previous.
Yeah.
And then this past season, you guys came in first place and you were presented with the offer. What was it? $275,000. And since they won and Johnny got more points during the final than Sarah did, because they were also competing against each other within the competition, bizarre and twisted. Mm-hmm. Johnny had the opportunity to either keep all of the money for himself or split it with Sarah, and he decided to keep it all for himself, leaving Sarah with nothing.
Yeah. And throughout the challenge, you guys were kept really busy. You were kept kind of hungry. You were kept uncomfortable. So you didn't really have a chance to, like, have a dinner and sit down and be like, hey, let's connect, like you did the whole season. Right. You had to kind of just throw things at him, like, hey, like, we're gonna split this, right? And he would be like, don't think about that.
I know.
Like,
that
he kept accusing you of being paranoid.
It was like a lot of
I mentioned it in a period of like 36 hours.
Yeah.
I mentioned it 3 times.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they showed
that
all
seemed
of
and every time
like
you brought
not
it up.
A lot yeah. to me.
Sounds reasonable.
In
to
a
me.
Competition where there's that much. Right. Seemed like that was an okay number.
Yeah. Yeah. And he made every time you brought it up, he was like, why would you bring that up for the 50th time?
Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know. What are we doing right now? Am I supposed to be thinking about something else? Is that why we're on the show?
I identified, though, with how you handled that, because I was like, if I were in your shoes, I would have really tried to push myself to be very, very fucking delicate, especially in
Johnny.
That situation. Yeah. It's like you don't even want to think about that outcome, but you have to.
Have to. I knew that was, as soon as they said, I was like, well, I'm fucked. This is how it's going to end.
I couldn't believe it. Even when he said it, I couldn't believe it. I thought he was joking.
I know. I didn't know what I, but I really do think if I could do it all over again, I would have let him win every one of those checkpoints.
Really?
Because
you feel like you emasculated him?
Uh-huh. I know I did, because he mentioned that about 10 times during the challenge. And then when we did the zip lining, I was down there way before him. And he's up there with the girls dangling up there.
His ego can't take that.
Johnny! Bananas.
Yeah.
You think he's going to be okay with letting me kick his butt? And then when he did the puzzle upside down, and I came over there, and he thought it was, I was... How dare I?
I know
come
he
over.
Mentioned that. He said that on the show.
Being,
he was like,
whatever he said, boastful or whatever, for coming over and flipping my partner's puzzle the right way up when we're competing together to try to win $275,000. You're out of your mind.
Yeah.
If you twist it that. So, you know what? Whatever.
Yeah. And obviously, the important thing for you is it seems like you are completely kind of getting over it, and you're fine, and it is what it is. It doesn't change the fact that, like, it was the contrast for me. It was a great, happy season watching you two hang out and do a great job. And, like, I kept calling you guys the dream team. I was like, you guys are the dream team.
That's what
you can't fucking lose.
Yeah.
And then for that to happen, it was, like, really sour ending, and I think that's kind of how it felt. And then at the reunion, you obviously were super frustrated and bitter, and you kind of left with these feelings that you felt like you couldn't deal with because no one wanted to hear you. What was that like, having to go in there and...
I would have redone every single little bit of that. That was the worst. I went in there and said, I'm not giving these people anymore. I'm not saying another word. I was like, okay, fine, then pay me more money and then I'll talk. No, they were like, no, you got to do it. It's in your contract. You got to go. Okay, fine. Sit there, say nothing. And it just felt like I was getting attacked from all sides. And it was like Johnny's camp. And then nobody else was standing up except Devin. And nobody else was saying anything. And then Wes says his thing.
Bless Devin.
Bless Devin.
For real,
thank
though.
God for
real.
Devin.
I really enjoyed
him. He's the greatest.
Yeah. He grew on me big time in that last
You know what
season,
I worry about? I think he's too smart for. I think they're not going to bring him back because they see him as somebody
he's
who gets
it. Out.
I really do.
That doesn't surprise
I think me. They. I really do. I would say that they may go. No, nope, he's not a sheep.
Fuck.
I know.
Yeah.
That's brutal.
Yeah. So we'll see.
We need more egos. We need less brains.
Right. Right. Yeah. That's really what I think that is happening, and I think he would agree.
Wow.
But, so I felt like I was totally alone up there, and it was just and then. Johnny getting up there and twisting it into like, well, you're the one who said all's fair in love, war, and challenge. Like, you said what I said. And because when we were, that is not what he said when we were on the mountain.
Right? Yeah.
When we were on the mountain, what he said to me was, and he gave a big old speech, like he'd been preparing this for the past 2 days.
Yeah.
And he said to me and to TJ and to everything, like to save face, he said, well, Sarah, you know, I just look at the life that you have and, you know, I see you're in grad school and, you know, you're married and all this stuff. And I just really want that kind of life for myself. And I really think it's time for me to hang up my hat. And I think this money would really help me do that. Bullshit. He's going to be on the next one.
Yeah.
Of course he is. Because that's his own.
It was his own justification. So
it was his own. And then he came home and needed like a new one.
Yeah.
And what I think is not fair is that That's fine and great, but don't, the fact that he gave me such a hard time is what makes me angry. Mm. Because if you're going to be like, he called me Judas. He said all this shit on, like,
Judas?
Yeah, Judas. And I go, who says that? Judas. And every time I walked in the room, he would get people to say horrible things about me and throw things at me. It was like ridiculous. And then he turns around, he does the exact same thing. And I'm not, you know, it just is so backwards to me how it's fine for him. The behavior is excusable. And if I were a man, I don't think he would have done that.
I don't think you're wrong there. I just think that it's interesting when he says that about your life, that he wants that for himself. Yeah. Instead of going out and going to graduate school and paying for it and getting jobs and, you know, earning
your own relationship,
that makes me crazy when people are like, oh, I love your fucking relationship. I wish I had one. It's like, it's not something you wish for.
Every day.
I'm like this happy and how I have this great life because I don't make selfish decisions that throw people under the bus and do things like that. I try to help other people.
And Johnny wants all of the benefits of your hard work or you're working on your education and your relationship and your life. And winning a bunch of money is not going to do that for you.
No.
And he is the perfect example of someone who does not know how to or doesn't want to transition out of being a reality personality because he doesn't. That would, you know, make him have to reflect and internalize
who decide
who I want to be and what I want to do with my life and actually do that.
Yeah.
It's easier terrifying. For him to stay in the reality world and let people, you know, just let him do his thing.
Yeah.
And he's sad because he wants to be a person, but I really do.
There is sadness like that I have for him because it really
there's
is.
There's a good person in there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I just know people like, I've had the privilege of learning a lot in school about this kind of stuff. And I think that the only time Johnny will find peace with that is if he ends up talking to a therapist or something like that, and it'll be going in for depression or anxiety because he'll never go in for, you know, but I mean, who knows? Maybe he's fine. Maybe he rests his head on his pillow at night. Maybe everything's great.
And he audibly says the word scoff.
And I don't want to make any assumptions about him.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, it does, and you know that, and you're carrying on with your life, because you know that will do you no good. You need to keep working on yourself like every other person in the entire world has to every day.
But it does sort of seem like, you know, in the moment he can make any decision that he wants and say, you know, this is what I've done with my life and I need to take this money because it's been a lot of years for him as well.
Yeah.
But he's not going to go and do something with that money.
And you know what I thought was silly is afterwards, like Susie really tried to like, hey, like let's do stuff. Let's really like make the most out of this, you know, come on our show. We can like tease things. Right. Let's not let other people make all the money. Let's do it for us. Like
right.
you start your own thing, do more than just like make some banana shirts, like take advantage of it. And he was like too proud he didn't want anything to do with it.
Yeah.
And didn't see that couldn't be cool with letting everything go. Like I can understand that's television.
Right.
And then after everything came out with the reunion and all that stuff, I was like, holy shit, this is like real life everything for him.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm in too deep. I got to just check out.
Cause you have a life to go to when you get home. And then for some people or cast members of a lot of reality television shows, this is their life.
It's really
and
crazy.
And you see them stirring it up and trying to perpetuate it and drag it out because I don't think that they want to sit with their actual life.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to say their names, but there were a group of girls at the bar where I met you that came over to my house afterwards. They were on a reality show years ago, and they were worried that it wasn't going to get picked up for another season, and they were all freaking out, and one of them was like, don't worry, like I heard such and such network is going to pick it up, we're going to have jobs, don't worry, and it didn't get picked up. And I just remember sitting there being like, you guys have already won half the battle.
Right.
You're smart, you're entertaining, you're interesting, people like you. So the logical thing to do with that isn't to wait for someone to give you a job.
Right.
Go make your own job.
You've done that.
You have a life. You have things to do.
And
I don't think that maybe someone who's that, you know, heartless or cutthroat in these television shows, I think that is their plan. They don't have a plan for their life after that.
You separate church and state.
Really well.
Like you keep your challenge life and then you keep your life.
Well, you know, it's such a strange thing because I come home and, you know, my husband's a little bit older than me. He's like 8 years older than me. And he was a fan of the challenge. There you go. Oh, my God. but he was a fan of the challenge in the beginning, but he isn't like, he doesn't want to talk about it. He says that it's kind of like the Wizard of Oz. Like, he's seen the man behind the curtain, and now it's like not as entertaining or as exciting.
Yeah, he knows how the sausage is made.
He knows it. He knows too much. So it's like not fun for him. Yeah. So he doesn't really want to talk about it ever.
Yeah.
But then I'm out on the street, or we're at restaurants, and people come up and they want to talk about it. So it's like this weird thing where I'm allowed to talk. I'm not allowed to talk about it at home, or and my friends like are like, I don't give a fuck. Right?
Yeah.
They're like, you're Sarah, who was like the nanny for my kids, and that, and we're gonna go drink some beers, and like that, not Sarah from the challenge. And so it's so separated. But then when I'm out in public, they're reminded when somebody's like, "Can I take a picture with you?" And then I have one friend who's like, "Why the hell does somebody?" Oh, right. It's like, why the fuck do they want to take a picture with you? Oh, because you're on that thing. And so it's just that a thing. Weird, different world. And I definitely have not, you know, I've made a few really close friends from the show, but it's not all consuming to me. So it's easy to kind of.
It's like if your job is what you do for a living, there are people that have a problem because that's their identity.
Yeah.
And then there's people who just have a job. You know, doesn't define you.
And
the show
is cool. Like, let people be on the show. Like, let people. I don't want to, like, people. I don't know. Like, maybe some reality star out there is like, why she like me and I'm cool or whatever.
Right.
I'm not saying everybody is like this, but I don't know. Most of them are.
But that's on purpose. It's not the people's fault. Maybe it's
well,
it's
I
in
think
casting.
Also,
they're looking for these people.
Yes, absolutely. Right. And I say this too is like I. It took me a long time to get it.
Mm.
It took me a long time because they make you feel like you're the balls in your court. They make you feel like you're the star and you're the big deal and you're everything. But you're so easily replaceable.
Mm-hmm.
You don't say yes to that phone call. Great. There's like 100 other people who will say yes. So it's getting it. And once I got it, once I was like, oh, my God, they're absolutely TJ's was told to use those exact words because there's a reason behind everything. And I saw the bigger picture and I should have like up on the top of that mountain. If I would have. It's impossible to see the big picture when you're in it, when you're so deep. Like when I was, and don't think that's not intentional.
Right.
We're exhausted. We have no food. Like the food is you have to like beg for a soda. Like
they strip you down so you're not able to really think for yourself or
you
make
can't.
Some
no.
sort of.
And you don't, and you, yes, it like takes up all your mental bandwidth. Yeah. So there's like none left over to make any sort of like, I don't
not
know, cerebral, like...
We had John Cochran on the podcast from Survivor.
From Survivor,
Oh, there you go, same kind of thing.
A lot of similar things, and that the way that it's going on in your head is that, you know, you're going to make this big thing, or all this stuff is happening in your mind,
but in reality,
when you watch the show,
so
it's like, you're in this part of this much of the episode, and that wasn't the actual storyline that was going on that they're portraying at all.
Yeah, so you're hungry and alone, and you don't know what to do, so you think everything's about you.
Yes.
But it's not.
And then they go, and then you go in interviews, and they ask you all those things. You're like, oh, surely this is all that matters.
Yeah.
And you're just so deep in it. And I wish I would have been able to step back for a second, realize what was going on, and then right before hitting that finish line, sat down and said, nope, I'm not going any farther.
Unless you promise.
But I didn't get it because I was too
Sarah,
and
2020 is hindsight.
Oh,
and it's always, I mean.
Ugh, it kills me.
It kills me, and I wasn't even there. So
remember how you say in that video that you were like stewing on it, and like it just, I stew on the like regret is like the, I say this on my podcast all the time that regret is like the and shame are like the worst feelings.
Yeah.
You can't get rid of them.
Yeah,
that regret for not being smarter when there was no way for me to be smarter.
No,
I mean, like
it
just in the moment, it just eats at me.
You're way too hungry to be any smarter than you were, or in a situation like, where it was like you were so like in a bubble.
And he made me feel so excited when we run across the finish line. He was like tearing up, and I was tearing up. He made me feel so happy. He was like giving me
hugs
and kissing
me. I'm getting
Julian's
triggered.
So,
oh my God,
it really makes me feel good though when I, you know, have people to, because I don't really get to vent about this very often.
No,
and
I'm excited.
Susie's like,
oh,
I've heard it.
Yeah, I'm sure she's. Yeah, we're gonna take a very short break so we can talk about the tracker. We'll be right back. Whoa, I don't know what happened, but I'm all alone now. Everyone is gone. But it's just for a second, guys. I just want to tell you quickly about our sponsor this week, Tracker. Guys, this tiny coin-sized device right here, this little thing. which makes a noise and has actually our face on it. I don't know if you can see. Probably can't because it's tiny. That's how tiny it is. This makes losing things a thing of the past. Tracker is a tiny device, this right here, that locates misplaced keys, wallets, bags, computers, anything in seconds. You just pair Tracker to your smartphone. There's an app for it, really intuitive, really easy to use, and it can find its precise location in just the tap of a button. It's pretty incredible. I've put this thing on my drone, on my boosted board, in my camera bag, in my laptop bag, in our luggage when we travel. Like anything that you are afraid of losing, you can throw a tiny little Tracker in and you will have to worry no more. If you lose your phone, just press the button on Tracker and your phone rings, even when your phone is on silent. With over 1.5 million devices, Tracker has the largest crowd GPS network in the world, so your lost item shows up on a map, even if it's miles away from you. Never lose anything again with Tracker, guys. Right now, you can get 30% off your entire order when you go to thetracker.com. That's thetracker.com and enter promo code Jenna Julien. You'll get 30% off your whole order. And I really encourage you guys to try this because nothing is worse than losing something you care about, whether it's something small like your keys, or if it's something more important like a camera of yours that you've saved up for and now you don't ever want to lose. You can have the peace of mind with Tracker. I very much encourage you to try it, guys, right now. thetracker.com, promo code Jenna Julien. You will get 30% off your entire order, and you will not be disappointed. And it makes a cool little noise, too. All right. Thank you for listening. Back to the podcast with our awesome guest, Sarah. All right, and we're back, guys.
We're back.
Thanks for listening to the sponsor. Thanks for listening to me alone and the podcast where I'm talking about the sponsor. Anyway, I wanted to quickly talk about your podcast. It's the Brain Candy Podcast. I told you I listened to an episode the other day, and it's really good. And
thanks.
It's super cool. I love how you guys have a good back and forth. That's like one of the biggest things for podcasts, I feel like, is if you're listening to a conversation that you feel like, all right, this is a good conversation. They clearly have some chemistry. You almost at 100 or you passed? You're almost at
100. We are at episode 73.
Oh my God. Yeah, that's a lot of episodes.
Congratulations. Big deal.
You guys, if you want to check out our podcast, it's Brain Candy Pod on Twitter and thebraincandypodcast.com.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Check it out.
We have super really fun stuff. We have book club. One of the things I'm most proud about.
Your book club?
We have a monthly book club that you can join. And it's not just like, hey, we hang out and read some books. We have like live streams and stuff like that with the actual authors of the book that reading.
What?
So we're reading these super awesome books. So did you see on the challenge the Up All Night challenge that we won? Where you memorized things that were going on all night long and you had to stand on the boxes?
Yes. Yes.
Well, we smoked that challenge.
Yeah.
And I won it because I used a trick that I read in this book called Moonwalking with Einstein that was all about remembering things.
Holy shit.
And so that was our first book club book we did. And we had one of the characters from the book come on and like talk about his experience in the book. So this is like a super awesome book club and people should totally join.
Literal brain candy.
And so that's what we try to do is like laughter and learning and like try to make it fun because there's like a bunch of cool stuff that we read and we like to curate awesomeness for people to like talk about and
that's
everybody
dumb.
Leaves
yeah.
going, oh, I have some cool stuff to tell my friends about.
Yeah.
Because I mean, my husband's done listening to me.
No. No, podcasts are dope and I love when you know segments like that are, you know, created on podcasts. It's a lot of fun like that. And I'm always looking for new podcasts to listen to. I don't know about you guys. I'm never, I can never have too many podcasts.
Well, I just started listening to this one and I love it. But here's what I most
It gets weird.
That's why I love it. But here's what I'm most upset about is that I came 1 week too late.
Why?
Because last week was tipsy and games, and I was like, what?
It's in your wheelhouse.
Oh, my God.
I mean, I don't know you personally, but I know
everything.
You from television, and I know that you like your games and your tangrams and to hang out.
I was yelling at my radio on the way here when you guys were playing Obama Llama.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my gosh. I was yelling, and I was like, he's the worst.
I'm the worst.
But also the best, but also the worst.
Yeah, wait till you hear the celebrity trivia ones. Have you listened to those?
I haven't got there yet.
That's bad.
You are not good at that at all. You and my mom should have a horrible at celebrity trivia off because you're terrible.
We should. You know, we recorded that podcast.
That Julia Roberts and Sandra Bullock are the same.
No.
Person. He can't tell them apart.
And Anne Hathaway. They're all the same.
They're all the same.
Don't come on our podcast and tell me they are not the same.
I think Sandra Bullock and I would be besties in real life.
Really?
My husband's like,
Which
that's what
that?
Stalkers say.
That's what
she says. Which one is she?
She also lived right close to me, so also what stalkers say. But I really do think we would be friends in real life if she's out there. Sandy, I'm your gal.
Yeah, I think she actually does listen to our podcast, so make sure you find her on Twitter and figure that out. No, for real, the drunk podcast, I woke up the next day, actually 2 days after when it uploaded, and I started to see comments because I didn't have time to watch the whole thing. I started to see comments of like quotes that I was saying. I was like, I don't remember any of this. I literally don't remember these things that I'm saying.
But anyway, I love it. So well done, guys.
That's how our podcast started.
Oh, I love that.
We would get drunk and do live streams on Ustream. And
it's a great idea.
People were like, I'm not up at 3:30 in the morning on a Saturday. Is there any way you could record these and upload them so we can watch them not at that time?
Right.
Yeah, we should make that.
Yeah. Oh, so funny. So, well, I'm glad you did.
Yeah, thanks, dude.
So you have the podcast going. You're in grad school.
Yes.
And I think it's really interesting, like the idea of having a practice. I want to just jump back to that.
Oh, yeah, really quick. Let's love chatting about that.
That specifies in, like, you know, reality TV people. And I don't even think you would need to really, once you had your practice, I don't think you need to do anything besides like network a little bit. You know what I mean? Like, barely. You network a little bit.
People and are dying for this.
Yeah.
I mean, I have talked to former cast members, like recent former cast members from the challenge, all of them. I'm like, please, I need somebody to talk to.
Yeah.
They go talk to somebody else and they get diagnosed with PTSD.
Yeah.
That diagnosis is flying around people who have been in
reality TV,
television situations. And that, I would like want to put out like a call to action for production companies who need to give. I really do think that, like, it sounds like such a trivial fight or plight or whatever when there are so many other things that are going on, and that, you know, I originally went on reality television because I'm an advocate for sexual abuse victims, and I work with nonprofit organizations and spoke out on that for a long time and still am very active in working with that. And that there was so much trauma involved that it was almost too heavy for me and too close to me. So I had to step back and say, okay, well, what other group do I feel like needs servicing and needs help that isn't getting reached? And I saw so many of my people that I cared about who were suffering afterwards. I said, this is a strange group that has put a lot out there and sacrificed a lot that aren't getting, I don't know, that are kind of falling through the cracks or just kind of get tossed to the side. Yeah. It feels very victimizing when you get used for television. You know, I like Camilla lost her grandmother on this season.
And didn't go home.
And then her exit was not pleasant. Mm-mm. And I said, I was like, did you get grief counseling after that? Did anybody offer you anything like that? Like any sort of, and I watched it. I even journaled about it. And I was like, she's going through the stages of grief right now. Right. I can tell you exactly what that's step three that you're seeing,
like,
you know,
on TV,
that's on television. Yeah. And I just, like, so many people put it out there and they're just being themselves and being honest, and they don't see the whole like machine working behind them. And then they just get like an old used rag, like on to the next season. Who's going to give us more?
I saw an interview with one of the contestants of, I think it was Olivia, The Biggest Loser.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, that losing all that weight and all that, like,
there's a lot of studies on them.
And then they say that they offer them some services, well,
and
most
of them
still
gain it back.
And they sit with all of that difficultness of everything. There's all seasons of those people that need help.
I think there's a responsibility.
There's an entire world out there of people
and it's different for different types of reality shows, but there's the same
underlying thread.
It's that feeling of like, I just got used for my personality, and now I don't know what to do with my life.
Because even if we said yes to doing it, people are people. Like, I look at what what's her name? Like Honey Boo Boo. Even I look at that family, and I'm just like, there is trauma under that. We are marketing and capitalizing on psychosis and on real problems,
and
not providing any kind of follow up.
The audience gets to watch it. This person, that's their life, and
there's nothing there for them to get help.
Right.
You know, everybody knows that we're like laughing at fucking Honey Boo Boo.
Yeah.
And then we know that they have problems. And then when we see them in tabloids and whatever, we're like, oh, look at that fucking person being an idiot.
Mm-hmm.
But no one's there to actually help them.
And I think it also that Dr. Drew wrote a great book about this.
Dope.
Oh, he's so dope. And this book, I think it's called something about like the mirror or something, but whatever. It's a really great book about what happens when we see, as regular people, see this narcissistic personality exploited on television. It makes, he said in his own practice, he started to see the people as a whole change because their role models changed. How people in, you know, Midwest, wherever, see people reacting to trauma or to bad situations, people think, oh, well, that's like a normal way to react. So I'm going to react. Like everything's heightened. Everything's more drama. There's nothing is solution focused. Nothing. So it's like it's changing. It right. really is changing the fabric of how we are. And nobody's talking. And it's really right. scary because people and hiding it under with the name reality television is a dangerous thing to do because it is not reality.
It is. It's not. It's completely curated and crafted. But I mean, I don't think that there's a problem in and of itself of having other people be your entertainment.
Not at all.
You know, having reality shows be this. But like, you do need to offer these services to people so that they, although it's entertainment or just another thing for MTV or a network or whatever, you're replaceable.
Yeah.
They don't care. Like, you do have to treat people like people if you're going to exploit them in that manner. Offer some fucking counseling service.
And we're not talking about like thousands of dollars. I mean, like I would charge like $65 an hour for that's what like an entry level therapist charges. Five sessions of that, you're maybe spending what $300 on these people who you just made millions off of.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
And like if you think about it, it's a very small price. If you're production companies, it's a very small price you're paying to maybe have a counselor on set.
Yeah, that's what
I said. That covers your fucking ass in case some shit happens.
Absolutely.
You're like, that's a small thing you got to check off your list. You know, even if your intentions are just to not get your ass sued, like you're still doing something that could potentially help prevent something horrible.
Oh yeah.
At any given time.
I've offered. So
yeah, I mean,
we'll see.
I'm sure you watch. Do you watch the show Unreal?
You know, I caught one episode once, and it's almost
too close.
I have a friend who works as a lobbyist in Washington, D.C., and she said she can't watch the show Veep because, as funny as it is, it's like too close to what she really does. I can't watch Unreal because I'm like, oh, that's it. And I think you said in one of your episodes where you said, like, it's a caricature.
It's a caricature, yeah.
I don't think it's that big of a caricature. I mean, a little bit, but not much.
Mm. It's crazy.
At least the episode I saw.
All we can do is just, you know, speculate. Like, you were there. You might.
Sometimes
it's worse. I have such a hard, I can't do anything in television for me personally because it's hard for me to give up control of having someone else being able to edit me decide what to show. That makes me fucking crazy.
Yeah. It should.
It's fucking insane to me.
That's, yeah.
Does it not make you crazy sometimes? Where you're like, that's not what I said. I didn't say it like that. I didn't say it then.
And my hair's curly in that scene and straight in that scene. So what happened there?
The continuity is ridiculous here.
Yeah.
It didn't happen.
Yes.
Like, doesn't that fucking make you crazy?
Yeah. You just get used to it. And that's like, you almost always, thank God, I feel like I've gotten a true edit to how I really am, but I've been lucky because I haven't seen anything that was too terrible.
Terrible.
They get to choose what they put out.
It's nightmarish thinking about, like, if you were on a show like that. You know, I watch The Challenge and I'm like, I think to myself, like, what it would be like if I was on The Challenge and, like, I, you know, obviously know what kind of person I am. I know I'm not a bad person, but if I made like one tiny mistake and how badly it could be portrayed and then suddenly America thinks that I am that person.
Yeah.
Like that's a nightmare.
Nightmare.
And that happens all the time.
All the time.
Terrifying.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking terrifying. And so, you know, like what Jenna was saying, one of the things that, you know, we love most about living on the internet is we fucking sit down and edit ourselves.
Yeah.
And anytime we don't, we make sure
my voice
there's
is
no,
free, boy.
Yeah.
My voice
like,
is free.
Like, I'll be with a group of people and they'll all be vlogging, you know, and I'm nervous the next day. I'm like, oh, they edited a vlog that I was in and I didn't get to edit it. You know what I mean? That is makes
even
me
though
nervous.
You did nothing
even
yet.
Even though I did nothing.
Right?
You know what I mean? I have nothing to worry about.
Show. What is it? I don't know.
Well,
it's just
and then
crazy
there's
to think about.
You know what when somebody puts a camera in front of your face, like most of the time you're really aware of a camera being in front of your face. There's this weird line that gets blurred where now I'm not quite sure what I've said on camera, what I've not said. Okay. So you just have to make everything you
and
say.
And they have cameras in the corner.
Everything. Yeah. So, you know, yeah. I mean, that happens with sometimes on my podcast where I'm like, did we talk about this in real life or did we talk about this?
Was it a dream?
Did I dream that or did we talk about that? That
happens
all the time.
We've had that on podcasts. I wake up and I'm like, wait, was that a dream or did we actually say that on the podcast? Yeah.
Same thing.
So you think that you're not going to ever go back?
No, I don't think I'll go back on, I definitely won't go back on the challenge again. And if, you know, I always said, like, if they offered me something, you know, hilarious, like the bartender position at one of the houses where I can just be their, like, on-site counselor and bartender, I would say yes to that. But it would put me in control. It would get, I'm not letting somebody else move the parts anymore. And, you know, I hope that I don't have to really do it. And I can kind of do it where I run the show now. And, you know, with our podcast and with our online videos, and we got some YouTube channel up, and we do fun things. We go on little road trips, and
just subscribed actually today.
Ah, great! Well, we did tradesies because I subscribed to yours. So,
oh, yeah. Hell yeah!
Oh,
hell yeah!
Tradesies.
Well, you know, it's one of those things where you, with the position you're in right now, you just kind of have to take what's good about what happens.
Yes.
About all 10 seasons of reality TV, right? 10, including the real. Yeah. I mean, that's crazy. And you
crazy.
You have this amazing, awesome podcast, and you have your this life experience that has shaped you into who you are, and like it there were a lot of negatives, but there were probably also
a lot of positives. So many.
Yeah. I mean, I had this list prepared. It's funny. I had this list prepared of questions
Tell
I wanted
us about
to ask
your
you.
List.
of questions I want to ask you. Like, this is before I listen to your podcast. Yeah. So I wrote this list. I'm like, oh, what was your favorite location? What was the favorite activity? Like, what was it like? All this. And then I hear the podcast about you. You're like, oh, fuck that. I'm never going back. I'm like, I'm going to erase this list real quick.
No, but I don't want people to think that I didn't absolutely love.
Yeah.
But, you know, I am very, very, very grateful for what I got on there. And I would not be where I am today and have the mindset and attitude that I have today if I didn't meet such colorful people who have just taught me so much about human nature and about how we react when we're pushed to our worst and pushed to an edge and to our limits. And I think that was probably... I mean, I went into my grad school like interview and talked about that and what that taught me and how that taught me about how people react in certain situations. And I think it's been something that is going to be very helpful in my career in the future. And so I'm very grateful, and they took me to wonderful places and everything like that. You know, it just, you know, you just have to be like, I'm just aware.
Yeah,
of
there's the good and the bad.
There's the good and the bad. Yeah. But I'm just because bad things happened and, you know, just because there are some things that I feel like they need to change or that aren't right doesn't mean that there aren't some other things that are wonderful and fantastic and, you know.
Definitely.
Like anything.
Yeah.
Will you watch future seasons of the challenge?
No.
Ooh.
But here's why. I've never watched a season that I wasn't on. And there's only been one show that I miss because I have terrible FOMO.
Oh,
so you'll watch a season and you'll be like, damn, that looks so fun. I miss all those guys.
Freaking killed that. Yeah. When they did the final in Bloodline, or not Bloodlines, a Free Agent, so I guess I missed two. When they did the Free Agent final, I was like, that is my weekend. I am so upset that they did everything that I just did, like, at my brother's house last weekend. I was so angry. So I can't, there's this like serious FOMO. I can't do it.
I'm not going to lie. Watching that show, I kind of feel
Why do you think
sometimes.
I even started on the show? Because I was watching it when I was a kid, and I was like, well, I have to do that. Yeah. I went on The Real World. Who gives a fuck about The Real World?
How
I just wanted to be on the challenge.
I did. A fuck about it. I've seen, like, every season up until, like, recently.
Yeah,
I haven't watched the newer ones.
Who cares? Yeah. But, no, not who cares about you watching it. Who cares about the new ones? Because they're boring now. They're
terrible. I honestly think that a lot of the...
Yeah, I don't watch it.
I was like,
internet culture has killed a lot of what The Real World represented. Because it was a big deal back in the day, like watching all those seasons, it like really shaped a lot of people into who they are, honestly.
But you saw normal life,
right?
And we loved that.
Yeah.
And now you see this whole like, we'll bring in your exes, and now it's going to bring up skeleton
it's
from
so
dinner.
Fake.
That's fucking with people,
right?
I do not think it's okay to reintroduce somebody to like a long lost twin for television.
Right.
No, It's no.
Yeah, we've talked about that before.
That's on the podcast, okay,
with
for me.
The orchestrated drama and stuff where people are trying to entertain you and one up you and get these sound bites.
It's not
and
good.
Whatever. But yeah, when in reality, the reason why people are so drawn to the internet is because we find other people genuinely interesting
just
enough.
Normal ass
regular
just,
people.
Just, I want to watch you grocery shop.
Yeah.
I want to watch you organize your shoe drawer. I genuinely enjoy this.
Yeah.
Like, it's so refreshing on the internet, and even parts of the internet are getting too orchestrated now at this point.
Mm-hmm,
but it, people find other people genuinely interesting.
Yeah.
And fuck off with all this shit.
Yeah, well, you're watching.
I don't need to watch the real world jumping out of a plane.
Right. Like, I either. Just be people and just hang out and be cool.
Yeah. Yeah. And I never, you got me into the challenge, but I never watched the real world ever. And then the other day there was this fight. Between these two girls. One girl was clearly just racist and the other girl was black, and it was like, what the like they planted this girl in here.
Yeah, of
they
course.
Caused, and I'm like, this is ridiculous. This is like,
I don't need this.
Like, if I want, you know what I mean? Like, if I want to,
this is just making me feel sad and bad and weird.
Yeah.
Like, you guys did this
and then the girl
purpose.
Starts crying and you're like, wow. Like, what do these producers feel like right now? Like, after having, they know they just caused all this to happen and whatnot. But yeah.
I think we're so detached. I think they see us as like, I really do that. I think, here's the analogy I use, 'cause I won't even mention who I'm talking about, but, to save my own butt. What is it? Sea turtle.
Yeah.
But I have a brother who is
American Sign Language sign for
yes,
sea turtle.
Yes, I love that. That's awkward turtle, right?
Yeah.
So I have a brother who is a firefighter and EMT, and I always tell him, like, how do you pick people up, bodies off the side of the road and do the things that you have to do? I see a cut finger and I'm going to pass out. Like, right. How do you do it? And he says, they're not people anymore. They just become part of your job, and they don't have a story behind them. There's no family. It's just, this is a body. They're not people. It might as well be a dummy. And I really think that that applies to my situation as well.
I
and how
right.
I think that we are not, there's no way after 26, 20 something, then you add on the real world that we're talking over 50 seasons and 50 different groups coming through, that each one of those that you could, No. It's like a small business caring about their customers versus a big business.
Right.
Who's going to care more about and see the immediate effects of what they do in their customers?
This is why you need to watch Unreal, because I think that you're right, because it was a old producer of The Bachelorette that then went on to executive produce or something on the show Unreal. So a lot of it is, I imagine, relatively close to home in terms of what it actually is. But you see these characters go through the emotions of, like, I could be a human being right now, or I can completely detach and do my job.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that you're wrong. I think that it has to be the only way that you can cope with some of this stuff and be okay.
And be a producer who's able to be, yeah.
You know?
But you have to.
Yeah.
That's terrifying, though.
Terrifying. It really is.
It's fucking scary.
It's so, and then these are the people who are
terrifying.
Just like, puppet masters in the background, just like, you know. I get it.
Was your experience on The Real World any better or different?
Yeah, you know what it was? Because there was zero, that was a true, my season.
Brooklyn?
Right. At least. Brooklyn was a true documentary.
Right.
And it was done, the only thing that I am still questioning to this day, they told me they didn't do it, but I am estranged. I have not had a relationship with my father, who was my sexual abuser ever. And he called the Real World house, and I didn't give him the number. My mom didn't give him the number.
So you think they orchestrated something?
They told me that they didn't, but I don't believe that now.
Mm. Wow.
Because of what I've seen so far.
Yeah.
And that kind of stuff.
How many years ago was the Brooklyn?
That was 10 years ago.
10 years ago.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I was very different. I was like, I was a human doormat when I was like younger. Like, just yes, anything you want to do, whatever, blah, blah, blah. That challenge did give me a backbone, I'll tell you that.
That's true, huh?
Yeah. Thank
you.
You
kind of have to fight for yourself out there. You have to fight for your life.
Sink or swim. So.
Yeah.
I mean, if they did that, that's fucking sick.
That's terrible.
I mean, he called, and the strangest thing of it all is that you can find every episode of The Real World of our season up on Netflix and everything except that episode.
Shut up.
So my mom's like screaming conspiracy theory.
It's a conspiracy. Yeah.
My mom.
So there's literally a gap. It goes from 8 to 10 or something.
Yeah.
Like, what?
Yeah, it's episode 6. It just like skips it.
No.
On every single outlet for it. On MTV.com.
Oh my God.
So my mom is like, why did they take that down? So, I want that up right now. And my mom was like, you need to call them. I was like, and to what?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh my God, let me get on
Guys,
the phone with Netflix.
It's me. Guess what? Yeah. Remember how I was
Netflix,
in that episode?
This is dog.
Yeah. About to go down.
I was like, Mom, yeah. Pull your jets. Yeah. So.
Yeah. Oh my God, that's crazy.
So when that happened, when that went down, it was the season was happening, and did they like have you in for a confessional to react to it, and like
they
there was a whole thing?
He or? Called on the phone and I wasn't there, and my roommate took a message, and it's so creepy. They played like creepy music over it, and he was like, tell her it's a friend. And it was just like, it was so creepy. And then he called back the next day, and I was there, and he was just trying to tell me to, you know, that everything I'm saying is made up and it's not true. And
cool.
Basically just
thanks
like,
thanks for calling.
Yeah. I'm like, yeah. All right, click. I mean, yeah. it's all weird, but wow. You know, so that makes that made me.
I watched your season. I don't remember that. Fuck, yeah. Man.
That's crazy. Did they aired it though?
Yeah, oh. They aired that. They aired me. And then I just start bawling and, you know, call my mom, and I'm like, Mom, guess who just called? And, you know, she couldn't believe it. Nobody could believe it, because how to get, this was like the one place I felt safe. I was like getting harassed by him for a couple of years, and I felt safe there because I was like away from everybody. And then I'm like, how did he get that number?
Yeah. I mean, you'd think like in a house like that, that is the only place.
And I mean, they called everybody before. They knew they called exes of mine they know everything about you before you go. They know more about you than you know about yourself. Mm. So I don't know. I'm not saying, I'm just, this is the information. Choose
conspiracy.
To think about it.
Well, if you want to come back, we like to do conspiracy theory podcasts.
Oh, I love that.
All the way in it.
Yeah.
But I mean, other than that, your experience with the real world was better or
yes.
different? Well, because it's not like game showy. There's nothing to win. There's no competing.
And I just felt like I really learned a lot about people who I would never know about. I had the joy of living with somebody who was transgendered right before that subject really became a big talking point in so many different areas. And
like ahead of the curve.
Yeah. And I felt like, you know, I hope that my reaction, which was like, so what, big deal? That's great. Wonderful. Yeah. Be who you are. It was a good example to be, you know, like that it wasn't a big deal, and it wasn't for everybody in our house. It wasn't a big deal.
Right.
So I really hope that, you know, and we were nominated for a GLAAD award for that show, because I really would like to think that, you know, we made it, not we didn't do that. We very little, you know, but given the opportunity that we had, we did the right thing, where I think if it were different people, then it could have been a different message that they were sending. So I really do love the message that we sent of acceptance and understanding and all that.
10 years ago.
10 years ago, before all that happened. I mean, Caitlin, Caitlin
right,
from my season,
season
was like the first out transgender person on television, and I say mad props to her.
Really?
I really do think so.
Wow.
To my knowledge. And I mean, it was so great for them to do that, and wonderful for them to talk about that in a house with a Mormon kid who was totally okay. Like, you know, he may have had his own beliefs, but he was a good example of what somebody with different ideas should be like.
She's
and
respectful.
Yes. Yeah. And it was beautiful. That was wonderful.
Right.
You know, so that I loved.
But that was the real world. I know you didn't watch it, but like it was helping, you know, the teenage and young 20s, early 20s demographic see these real life situations play out like on their television, and what happens if you handle it this way, or what happens when you handle it. It's just watching other people live their lives, and it's really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And then the challenge is like taking all of those castmates on steroids and just fucking with them.
Yes.
You know?
That's what it feels like.
It's sick.
You're like, wait, I want to go back to Kumbaya where we learned about each other, and you know, but I can't say no to that. I couldn't say no for a long time to those challenges.
Well, they do look fun.
They are so fun. The actual challenges themselves are what
so fun.
I would pay to do that, but there's no place on the planet where you can pay money to do that stuff. And
no,
if you could, it would cost you so much money and insurance and all that stuff, and people like, where do you get to jump
out
of a plane?
The closest thing to anything I've seen in the challenge was last weekend. My friend Instagram videoed him going to like a soccer place where you put yourself in a giant ball.
That sounds amazing.
Run into each other.
Yes,
that's the closest real life experience to the challenge.
So now you can like every 2 days find something equally as awesome to keep you that excited.
Yeah.
For
no,
2
I mean,
months.
Competitively, like, yeah, that sounds like I would love to do everything on the challenge, but.
And money. Also, remember that thing we all love? I love it.
True. Are people I just want to ask some general fucking questions.
Ask some general
as a fan of the show. Like, and
do
you.
It.
Yeah.
Are those people fucking crazy, man? Are you people crazy?
Insane. Absolutely.
You don't strike me as the craziest person.
Well, and also I'm like the least exciting on there.
I mean,
I'll be emotional and I'm like, but you're open not and everything.
Camilla Nader throw a chair in the pool.
Never ever. And I watch it.
You gotta die.
No, that is the greatest scene where she just walks off the edge into the pool. It's the greatest television scene. Yeah. I love that. That is why reality television is amazing.
It was like a psychological thriller, and she just walks in.
Psycho!
The pool.
And she just walks up. I'm going to tell you some information after this is over and why she got extra crazy. Ugh. Sorry, people listening.
Yeah.
Insider information.
See, okay, but once again, we can watch this, be entertained, and laugh, but like maybe just offer Camilla some counseling afterwards.
Yeah, right.
But yes, that scene where she walks into the pool, you're gonna die.
It's so great. I see these people, and I'm just like, what are you like in regular life? Because I had never witnessed a fight, an actual physical fight. Until I was on The Real World.
Really?
I saw my very first fight.
Sure.
And I was like, people do this. This is what a fight. And I got so scared I hid under a table.
Where are you from originally?
Orange County. L.A. I was born and raised in L.A. In Santa Monica. I was born in L.A.
What high school did you go to?
Grew up to. I went to Thousand Oaks High School.
Oh, I went to Samuel High.
Oh, look. We were like right... Yeah. My parents were in the film industry too, so it was like no big deal because I grew up in the film industry.
How did The Real World happen for you?
I went to an open casting call in San Francisco, and I was with my neighbor. We heard an interview or a commercial on the radio about it, and he was like, we're definitely going to do this. And he got pink eye that day. And so he was like, I'm not going. And he's like, but you still have to. And so he made me go. And I was like, okay, if there's a line, I'm not doing it. And we went the very last hour of the very last day they had it. And there was no line. And everybody in line was like, I could remember it. They were like, I'm going to say that I'm like crazy. And I'm like, puck. And I'm like, this person I drink. And da-da.
Puck.
And I was like, okay, well, I'm a camp counselor who doesn't really party. And, you know, I was like boring, I thought. And I just went out there and was myself. And they did a group casting call and sat us all together. And there was a woman who was leading this whole like group interview. And I just kind of took over and was like asking all the questions. It was like, oh my God, tell me more about that. So was that... And then I think they were like, oh, well, we need somebody to interview people. So
true.
I was just a house therapist from day one and never got paid for it. That's why I'm in this profession now, so I can finally make some money on the back end.
Are you glad that you made that decision to do it?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I'm very glad. You know, I really felt like it was such a just with the work I've done afterwards for, I'm an ambassador for a nonprofit organization. I've done so much work with them. That has just been so fulfilling and like hearing the people who just were moved when I shared my story of sexual abuse and sexual trauma on television made it all worth it because I didn't have anybody like that had been through like that made me feel like it was okay and not a big deal.
Yeah. And you changed their lives.
To me is like, if one person felt better, then, that's like the old cliche, but that really is how I felt.
Yeah.
And I didn't know how strong that was going to be. I just wanted to be on the challenge, you know. And both worked. And so win-win.
Yeah,
great.
True.
Do you have a favorite location that you've been?
Yes, yeah. Thailand. I even went there for my honeymoon because I loved it so much.
I've heard so many
people.
I want
to go to Thailand.
Oh, you should. And you know what? All you need is the plane ticket because once you get there, you couldn't spend $400 in a week if you tried.
Really?
It's like you walk down the street and it's like, oh, $6 massage. Oh, I'm okay. I'll do $6 massage. You finish your massage. You're like, oh, a $4 pedicure. Okay, I'll do that too. And you're just like getting rubbed and like lotioned and then eat good food. And then you go in the pool or the beach and then you get out of the beach. And there are people giving you massages on the beach. It's the great. And then they give you like food and the people are the nicest people on the planet. That's why I love it.
I've heard amazing things about Thailand.
The nicest people.
The food's really good too.
Oh, it's so good.
We should go to Thailand.
Totally.
Do you have a favorite all-time actual physical
God. What's TJ like? Oh, is he magical?
He is magical. He's everything you want him to be and more. He's everything.
TJ gets fucking pissed
off. Oh, me too.
You quit.
That was the best.
You gotta go.
Bye. Yeah. See you never.
TJ's
don't have fun. Don't have a good time. See you never.
Mad. You make TJ mad.
Yeah, that was the best.
All right, then. He like fucking makes people feel awkward when they're trying to be funny and shit.
Oh, okay, so that was a horrible joke. Yeah, he's just so funny. And he's a cool dude.
Yeah.
And I just love his whole... Like, I've never met a man who's more motivated and more, like, he wakes up early and he goes to bed early and he hustles all day long and he doesn't drink and he doesn't do drugs and he's, like, just a good person who cares about helping other people and he's the guy who will stop on the side of the road and, like, fix your car.
This is making my day, man.
He's the coolest.
Awesome.
That's dope.
That's
do you guys get to hang out with him ever?
Well,
during the
afterwards, he was the one person who, after the challenge was done and everything went down, he, like, came up and he was, like, You won the right way. You know you did. Like, he was just,
good
like,
guy,
the guy.
TJ.
He and he was just real sweet to me afterwards. And, like, you know, just, it's just cool. And
that's
just
awesome.
Fuck
have
yeah.
a special place in my heart for
that teaching. That makes me happy.
Yeah. And on my first challenge, I got in trouble because we all went out one night. Oh, my God, I almost dropped my drink. We all went out. I'm just so excited to talk about TJ. We all went out one night to, like, this Thai boxing place. And, you know, I didn't know the rules. Like, we're not allowed to hang out with TJ. So, like, I just go over and I sit next to TJ. And I'm like, so who are you putting money on? And, like, everybody was like, what the hell is she doing? Like, I wasn't allowed to do that. I was like, I'm just hanging out. And then the producer was like, get over here. Don't talk. And after that, I was like, what? I didn't know that there was, like,
well,
this whole
thing.
Yeah, I was like, I've been dying
that's
to hang out. To just I just wanted to, like, you know, see who's
running. Anything I came to Thailand.
Right, exactly. So, you know, ever since then, I've just always had a special place in my heart for TJ. And
that's
like,
really good.
Know, now I'm like, I think we're allowed to hang out.
He's
as cool as you think. He is.
Yeah, we had, like, I, you know, she said we had Cochran from Survivor on the podcast, and he's good friends with Jeff Probst now. Who
oh, cool.
Is
he says the same thing. He's such a cool guy.
He's
yeah.
such
like,
a cool guy. And
so
he's
happy.
Friends with him,
we
and it, like, warms
so
your
cool.
heart, because you, like, it's like... They're the dad figure. They're dad.
Yeah, and you know
there.
What? They're removed because they're not the decision makers in
no.
the shit. Right.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
like, TJ cared, you know? Like, when he sees people put it on the line, he doesn't care about... He doesn't know what's going on, how...
Yeah.
At least I
you
think.
Can tell.
No, for
you
sure.
Can
he
and
just,
he sees
he cares, so.
Season after season, and he's seen you for 9 challenges, so he knows what type of competitor, what type of person you are. Of course, he respects you. He respects the people who deserve respect, which is awesome. And that makes me feel happy that he's a good person, so...
He did ask if he could be paired with any female, who would it be? And he chose me. So
aww.
I almost started crying.
Awesome.
So he went on another podcast and said that. And so I was like, oh my God, my life. I can just like rest, die happy now because TJ. That's all I wanted, validation from TJ, who like gave me the nod. So
I just need to know what TJ was like. I'm good now.
Yeah.
We can end.
Yeah,
I'm good.
Hey,
what does he smell like?
For real though.
No, I want to know. Yeah. Do you have a favorite like physical challenge?
I think the up all night one was
really?
My, just
really?
Because when I tell you we smoked that one, it was embarrassing how fast we finished. Like, I think production was like, we were not expecting somebody to finish this fast. We finished in under 2 minutes what took close team like 20-something, and we got it right the very first time. And
just
it was
to clarify,
just
this
so
was a
fun.
Challenge where they had to stay up all night, and weird things kept happening, like circus performers would jump in the arena, and you would kind of just be watching this. You didn't know why, and at the end of it, they asked you trivia questions about specific details, about the color
it.
Of things.
I loved it so much.
Yeah, and you guys destroyed it.
Because it's like annoying how I remember these things in real life. And I've never been able to use this annoying skill that I have. And then I felt like the skill was like able to be put to use. And I was like, it's this. Or trivia. So trivia, anything like that, trivia, anything where basically I'm like such a narcissistic asshole that anything where I can show off and make other people feel shitty. So that's what I like.
If there was a challenge where you had to like run through someone's kitchen and make it a mess really fast and then leave, I would
do you be good
that.
At that?
Oh man, I'm so good at that.
What do you think is your messiest meal you cook?
Every meal.
Everything.
Well,
every meal.
I'm just so focused on getting it done so fast like I'll leave a wake of destruction.
That's how he achieves superhuman cooking speed, is that he doesn't clean
you
up
clean
anything.
It.
Or like close the refrigerator or any cupboards.
Oh no.
Or drawers.
Oh no.
It's a tornado.
We could not live together.
Yeah. It's like in hot dog eating contest. You see how they're just making a mess of everything?
Because
they're just
is that.
Yes.
That
the kitchen is my hot dog eating contest.
You also are not allowed to come over to my house and cook any meals.
All right. I'll stick to messing
cook,
up our
I'll
kitchen.
I'll cook for you.
Okay, sounds
there
good.
There you go. If you come to my house, I'll cook for you.
The Julian tornado, that's what she calls me.
That's really funny. I'm sorry.
It's okay. No, because I just follow the wake of the tornado and clean up.
Well, as long as the
we're
food
team,
is
though.
Good afterwards.
Well, that's the thing, is that
I wouldn't care.
He makes food in like an ungodly amount of time. It's like 5 minutes and you have like spaghetti. And
okay.
You're like, how did you
see,
do
you
this?
Know what's funny is spaghetti is where my mind went when you said messy. I was like, it's spaghetti. I know it. And you just said spaghetti.
Spaghetti.
I feel like you'd be spaghetti.
Mom spaghetti.
Yeah. You can't stop the Italian in me. It's fucking spaghetti all the time. Pasta every day.
Delicious. Carbs on carbs.
Carbs on carbs. For real, thank you so much for coming over and doing this podcast with us.
Me.
This was really, really fun.
It's really
such a joy.
Yeah. Our pleasure to have you.
It was absolutely our pleasure to have you. Everyone out there, guys, check out her podcast, thebraincandypodcast.com. It's an awesome show, and every single week, right?
Yeah, every single week. On Thursdays, we come out with new episodes.
Thursdays. You guys don't have any content from us on Thursdays.
Shouts out to Susie.
Susie, my gal. My other half, my better half.
Hi, Susie. Sorry, you're not on this episode. Maybe another episode you can come on our podcast, or we can crash
maybe
your
you
podcast.
Guys can crash ours, because we love having guests.
Hell yeah.
We would absolutely do that. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, guys.
And guys, check our stuff out, and make sure you check out The Tracker, which is the sponsor for this week, so you can track your belongings.
Oh my god.
Oh, that's a fun noise.
Go to thetracker.com, promo code Jenna Julien, you get 30% off. Thanks again, Sarah. Appreciate it.
Oh, thanks,
yay!
Guys.
Yay!
Yeah.
Can we high five now because we didn't get to it at the beginning? Yeah. Okay. Sweet.
We'll see you guys next week for another episode. Guestless, probably. Maybe drunk? No.
What?
Are we going to be guestless next week?
I don't know yet.
I'm not a fortune teller. I'm only a spaghetti teller.
All right. We'll see you guys next week. Bye.